Well, good evening, everyone. It is wonderful to see you tonight at Quail Springs Baptist Church. Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord? Amen. I am glad to see you here. Praise the Lord. It's been a great, great day today and throughout this week for our revived services. God has been moving. God has been working, and I know God has something special in store for us tonight. Our musical guests for tonight are the Bolerjacks. Are you excited about them tonight? Praise the Lord for them. Now, I'm excited tonight because I'm getting to preach for y'all tonight. I'm so excited. So tonight, we don't have a guest speaker, but I get to preach for you, and I'm excited about that. And so we'll have a great time with that tonight. But then I want to let you know about what's going to be happening tomorrow. Tomorrow, we'll be having our Wednesday night fellowship meal at 5 o'clock. I hope you'll come. It'll be a great, great meal. You don't want to miss it. Starts at 5 in our fellowship hall. And then at 6:30, we'll begin with our final revive service. Our musical guest will be Charles Billingsley, incredible worship leader, incredible soloist. If you've never heard him before, you're in for a treat. And if you've heard him before, you know what an incredible, gifted singer he is. And so you don't want to miss that. And then our guest speaker will be America's Minister of Encouragement, the Swan, Dennis Swanberg. He was here with us for a senior adult luncheon just a few months ago. God just used him in a great way there. He is hilarious, but listen, he brings a great, encouraging word from the Word of God. And I was in touch with Dennis this afternoon. He just told me he is so excited about what God is already doing here, and God's giving him a message just for us tomorrow night. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to stand to your feet. Will you just stand up for a moment? Turn to some people around you. Welcome them to the house of the Lord tonight. Tell them how thankful you are to see them in this place. Just take a moment and greet one another. Great, great night to be in the Lord's house. Take a moment to greet one another. Amen. Amen. And then if you will, once you've greeted one another, if you'll just remain standing for a moment, I want us to pray together as we go into the presence of the Lord and just ask God to prepare our hearts. Join with me as we pray together. Lord God, we love you, we praise you, we thank you for what you have already done this week at Quail Springs. Thank you, Lord, for people who have been saved this week. Thank you, Lord, for people who have made commitments to live for you more fully. Thank you, for those who have come to you who have been far away from you, Lord, and you've just reminded them of your love for them and their need for you. And now, God, we pray that tonight, once again, your Holy Spirit would work and move in this place. We pray, God, that we would hear your voice. We pray, God, that we would seek your face. And Lord, we pray that we would know your heart. Lord, thank you for what you're going to do. For we pray these things in Jesus' precious name. And church, if you agree with that prayer, will you say amen? Amen. Now, church family, if you will, welcome the Bolerjacks.
Debtors. into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom. And wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my sin. My sorrows, he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary. He suffered and died alone.
How marvelous!
How marvelous! How wonderful! And my song shall end.
My joy through the ages to sing of his love.
It's a privilege to be a part of these revival services. Yes. We are excited to be here.
We are Blake and Jenna Bolerjack. I hope I pronounced that correctly for you. This is my wife, Jenna. Isn't she pretty? We've been married 18 years, and we do this ministry together. I'm so grateful. But just so you can get to know us, we met in college. We met at Oklahoma Baptist
OBU.
University.
Yes.
And
it was a good one.
I am 4 years older than her. However, we graduated the same year. So
it took him a while to get through school.
Now, in my defense, she's extremely smart. And I graduated at 25, and I do not have a master's degree.
It's okay.
My parents are here tonight. They're just glad that I graduated, aren't you? So they talked about my education like it was prison. They'd say things like, "Did you hear? I think he's getting out this year." But I do remember the very first time that Jenna brought me back to her hometown of Carrollton, Texas, to meet her family. And her mother walked right up to me, very first things out of her mouth. You remember that?
Yeah.
She walked up to me, and she half jokingly called me a cradle robber. And for some reason, this thought came in my brain, and it came out my mouth before I could think. And I said, "Ma'am, if it makes you feel any better, I'm not that mature."
Yes.
So we're kind of the same age, really.
He said that, and I was like, "Stop talking. You're not helping the situation." No, but we've been married 18 years, and my family, they like him now. So it all worked out. But yes, we are here to lead you to only look at Jesus. Only worship him tonight. And so here we go. We got a lot of music to do. We want you to be able to sing. God's made your voice unique. No one has your voice. God wants to hear you praise him with how he's made you. Join us with Jesus Messiah.
Would you stand with us?
Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sin.
How great
God with us. Emmanuel.
Emmanuel.
I have a feeling you're gonna know this one too.
I wandered so aimless, my life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
How many of you know this song?
Yeah. Okay.
Amen. That's all right.
Just like the blind man, I wandered along. Worries and fears I claimed for my own. And like the blind man, that God gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
I saw the light, I saw the light.
A fool to wander astray, for straight is the gate and narrow the way. Now I have traded in the wrong for the right. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy. Sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
This little light of mine, let me see him, I'm gonna let it shine.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Oh, I saw the light, I saw.
Jesus, we get to go to heaven. We get to go and be with him. This life's not all we get. Oh, thank you, Lord.
They say that heaven's pretty.
There's no surprise that if you look, you'll see the homesick feeling in my eyes. I'm going home, going home, where I belong.
This next song is a brand new song for us. It was pitched to us a few months ago by a good friend of mine, and she just really knows how to turn a phrase and to paint a picture with words. And so I want you to listen to the lyrics of this song. Listen, we live in a time, in a day and age, where they tell us that there is no truth, but we know better. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. Listen to this song.
It looked like defeat on Mount Calvary when Jesus died on that tree. His story was doomed in that stone cold tomb, and darkness thought he was through. But on day three, Jesus breathed and walked out of the grave in victory. God hid the lion inside that lamb. Death couldn't hold the great I am. On this truth, my faith's gonna stand. God hid the lion inside that. Curse had been
graveyards bow before him. The powers of hell are so weak that they fail,
but heaven has hope to tell. 'Cause on day three, Jesus breathed and walked out of the grave in victory.
I'm running.
Let's see if you recognize this Bible story here.
What Daniel tells about a king who lived long ago, who built for all of Babylon an image of gold, set a fire, a hot furnace is waiting for you. If you don't bow and worship like I tell you to, read on a little further about three brave men. One in bow to the idol, no, they wouldn't give in. So the king got mad and said, boys, you're through. Let's see if your God can deliver you. And if saw Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, but who sat with them in the fire below? There were three men in, but there were four men walking around. King Nebuchadnezzar saw that they weren't dead, and the fire had singed one hair on their head. He said, I'm setting you free to worship as you wish, cause there's no other God who can deliver like this. And the Abednego, who sat with them in the fire below. There were three men in, but there were four men walking around.
Listen to this message.
If you're facing a fire and it's too hot to stand, the enemy's tied your feet and your hands. Remember the story and the lesson we learned. The ropes that tied them were the only thing burned. And they threw three men down into the fire. They were found and cast in a flame that was seven times hotter. They saw Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, but who sat with them in the fire below? They threw three men in, but there were four men. Abednego, who's that with me in the fire below? There were three men in, but there were four men walking around. There were three men in, but there were four men walking around. About
8 years ago, we went through a fire, meaning I went through breast cancer and I was 31 years old. And something really stuck out to me. I was just diagnosed, and you know, you kind of just tell your family first and then your friends. And I remember, my mom lives in Dallas, my parents live in Dallas, we live in Oklahoma City here. And I remember getting a text from my mom, like during that first week of just knowing my diagnosis, and she texted me, and she said, if only I could do cancer for you. And I just thought that was the sweetest thing. And it kind of got me thinking, cancer aside, obviously God used the chemo and the doctors, and he healed me from it. But our Lord took the cancer of sin and did it for us. Cancer taught me a lot, and it was a treasure actually, because I got to watch God be God to me. Let's lift our voices and praise Him for being God.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all. Right, you fill my cup.
sin, my cross, my shame. Rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all.
Sing to him.
Jesus.
Oh my, haven't we been blessed tonight? Yes, indeed. Please. Thank you all. I love that new song, by the way, that you sang. Well, I want you to reach in front of you tonight, and there's an envelope that has the word faithful on it. Would you reach and take one of those? Let me see all that movement out there. Yeah, that's good. Thank you for doing that. I'm going to ask the ushers if they would come and get in place, and let me share just a word with you tonight. Last June, our church and our pastor were honored as he was elected unanimously as the president of the Southern Baptist Convention Pastors Conference. And as a pastor through the years, I can tell you it's one of the most encouraging, strengthening, one of the times that I felt so blessed every year when I had the privilege of sitting and listening to some of the greatest preachers in the Southern Baptist Convention. And our pastor is leading that conference this year. He chooses those who speak, and he has a lineup that is second to none. And then he also has the wonderful privilege of raising the money to cover the cost of that event. Isn't that nice? They elect you and they say, oh, by the way, fact of the matter is that many folks have already given from around the United States. Many churches have already participated. And tonight we have the privilege of being a part of blessing pastors from across the Southern Baptist Convention. There will be somewhere around 4,500 pastors and their family members who will come to that conference. And having served for many, many years as a leader among Oklahoma Baptists, I can tell you there are a lot of pastors that are beat up and hurting and their families, and they need the encouragement that our pastor has prepared for them when they come to this conference. You know, we are blessed in our church that we've already had someone who has given a commitment of $50,000, a matching gift, and you and I tonight get the privilege of being a part of that offering. So I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm going to ask you to dig really deep tonight because we need this money to be able to do this ministry among pastors and bless them, and they need God's blessing in their life. And I promise you, this conference will be just that. So I'm going to ask you to fill out that envelope, drop it in the offering plate. There are also, as you know, places you can put the offering in the boxes as you leave tonight. But would you give a generous gift, and let's meet that matching gift so that we're going to be able to bless pastors all across the Southern Baptist Convention. And tonight, I want to pray for our pastor because he's going to come and bring the message tonight. I just got to tell you, I thank God for our pastor, don't you? What a blessing. I love you, Pastor. So I'm going to ask God to speak to your heart. I'm going to ask you to join Paul and me as we give an offering. I'm going to ask you to give generously, but I'm going to ask God to fall fresh upon our pastor tonight as he opens the Word of God to us. Will you pray with me? Father, this has just been an incredible few days that we have spent together. Every time we've come together, you have spoken mightily through your Word. You have led us in worshiping and adoring your wonderful name. And tonight has been no different. I thank you for the Bolerjacks who have blessed us tonight, who have spoken to my heart and the hearts of all of us, and given us the opportunity to express our praise to you. And tonight, I want to pray especially for our pastor. I pray, Father, you will anoint him, how we thank you for his faithfulness to the Word of God. And tonight, will you fall fresh upon him? May you speak through power and authority, and that it will be a demonstration of your power as we listen to the Word tonight, and we will feel the conviction of your Holy Spirit, and we will feel moved by your Spirit, and that we will respond as you speak to us tonight. And now, Lord, help us to be generous as we give, that this church that is so generous in so many ways all the time may now bless pastors across the Southern Baptist Convention by our generosity. For it is in your wonderful name, the name of Jesus, we pray. And all of God's people said, amen.
Oh, shame is the prison as cruel as the grave. Shame is a robber. He's come to take my name. Oh, love is my redeemer, lifting me up from the ground. Love is the power when my freedom song is found. There ain't no when I hear that trumpet sound, I'm gonna rise up out of the ground. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. Oh, 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 oh.
Sing that with us. Whoa.
with a smooth and velvet tongue. Fear is a tyrant, he's always telling me to run. Oh, love is a resurrection, and love is a trumpet sound. Love is my weapon, I'm gonna take my giants down.
Dear Lord, I thank you that that wasn't the end. That was not the end, your death on that cross. But it was just the beginning because you rose conquering death because you're God. Lord, I thank you that we are able to gather here and praise your name and worship you. Lord, I pray for the message today. I pray that our hearts are open. Lord, we are seeking you with all of our heart. We come expecting to hear from you. So we pray, will you reveal yourself to us in a new way today? That is what we ask. Thank you so much. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Church, will you express your appreciation to the Bolerjacks? Praise the Lord for them. And I tell you what, I am going to call every other preacher for this conference and tell them, brothers, I got to preach after the best song of the whole week. That was absolutely awesome. Thank y'all so much. I want you to take your Bibles. If you have a copy of God's Word, turn with me in your New Testament to the book of James, chapter 2. James, chapter 2. And tonight I'm asking this question: will your faith save you? Will your faith save you? And you may say, well, Pastor, everybody knows that we're saved by grace through faith. Absolutely, that's true. I'm asking you, will your faith, the kind of faith you have, save you? Because the Word of God, which is absolutely clear in telling us that we're saved by God's grace through faith, is also clear in telling us that there is a kind of faith that will not save. There is a kind of faith that will not take you to heaven. There is a kind of faith that will take you to hell. Will your faith, the kind of faith you have, save you? That's what we're going to be talking about as we look to the Word of God. When I was about 16 years old, my dad had a group of men that he met with every Thursday morning for breakfast. They'd get together really early in the morning, and they'd eat breakfast together at this little restaurant, little Greasy Spoon restaurant, not too far from our house. And somewhere along the way, when I was about 16, my dad told me that I could come and eat breakfast with these other guys. And so I would go. I don't remember whether it was before school or whether it was during the summer when I was off. I really don't remember. I just remember how much I loved being there with my dad and his friends and just listening to these guys before they go to work, eat breakfast, and they tell stories and talk about things. And so one week we were there and we were sitting around the breakfast table, and there was a guy who came every week. His name was Bill Alberti. And Bill was there, and he was sort of a colorful guy. He was telling us some things that he had done. And he said, you know, guys, he said, I went to the flea market. By the way, how many people here are familiar with the flea market? Y'all know what we're talking about. So Bill said, I went to the flea market, and he said, I was going from booth to booth and looking at the different things that were for sale. And he said, I came across this booth where they were selling wristwatches. And he said, there was a sign in front of the table where they had the wristwatches on display, and it said, all watches, $19.95. And so he looked and he saw one of these wristwatches. He picked it up and he asked the guy behind the table, he said, is this true? He said, is this really a Seiko watch for $19.95? The guy said, well, look at it on the face. It says Seiko. And he looked at it. He said, okay, Seiko watch, $19.95. He bought two wristwatches that day. He bought one to wear and one for later. And you know how it is when you get a new wristwatch. You're just hoping somebody will ask you what time it is. And so anytime somebody would ask him what time it was, he'd sort of flourish to that. And they'd say, Bill, you got a new watch? He said, yep. He said, Seiko, $19.95. I mean, he was proud of that wristwatch for the first several days he had it. And then after about 3 or 4 days, the watch just stopped. Second hand stopped, everything stopped. It wasn't working at all. And so he took it off and he tried to sort of mess with the stem, and that didn't do any good. And so then he started just hitting it in his hand just to see if he could, you know, dislodge something that was keeping it from moving. And it started to run counterclockwise. It's just going spinning in the wrong direction. And so he said, well, I don't know what to do. So he took it to a jeweler, and the jeweler took one look at it, and he said, sir, I can't do anything to repair your watch. He says it's good for as long as it lasts, but once it stops running, it's basically just sort of riveted together. And once it stops running, there's nothing that can be done to repair this watch. And Bill said, well, hold on now. It says right on the face of this watch, Seiko. Surely you can repair a Seiko watch. And the man took a look at it. He said, sir, you need to look closer at the face of that watch. He said, Seiko is spelled S-E-I-K-O. The face of your watch says S-I-K-E-O. He said, you've got a Seiko watch, not a Seiko. Now, some of you may think, that can't possibly be a true story. I am telling you, that is a true story. I heard it when I was 16 years old, and sometime back I was preaching in my hometown. I told that story, and Bill Alberti was in the congregation that night. And I started to tell the story, and he heard it, and he leaned over to his wife and said, "There's no way he's not talking about me." And after it was over, he came up to me, and I said, "Bill, did I tell it right?" He said, "You told everything just right." And here's what happened. Bill thought he had the genuine article, when in fact what he had was a cheap imitation. And there are a lot of people who go through life, and even go through church, grow up in church, come to church on a regular basis, and they think they have the genuine article. They think they have real saving faith, when in fact what they have is a cheap imitation. They have a counterfeit faith, a fake faith, a faith that will not save. I want to ask you the question tonight, will your faith, the faith you have, save you? I'm not asking you tonight if you've been baptized. We'll talk about being baptized. It's an important way of showing that we've been saved. But the question I'm asking you tonight is not, have you been baptized? I'm not asking you if you're a church member. It's an important thing to be a part of a church. That's where we grow in our relationship with Christ. That's where we serve the Lord and experience His fellowship with other believers. But I'm not asking you that question tonight. I'm asking you, will your faith, the kind of faith you have, save you? Because what a tragedy it would be for you to go through your life holding on to a cheap imitation faith that won't save you, when God wants you to have real saving faith. That's what James talks about in James chapter 2. We're going to look at verses 14 through 26 of this text. And in honor of the reading of God's word, I'd love it if you'd stand with me as we read together, beginning in verse 14 of James chapter 2. And there the Bible talks about what real saving faith is and what real saving faith isn't. Listen to what the Bible says. "What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, 'Go in peace, be warmed and filled,' without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also, faith by itself, if it does not have works, is," what's the next word? "Dead. But someone will say, 'You have faith and I have works.' Okay, show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that God is one? You do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? You see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, 'Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness, and he was called a friend of God.' You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. And in the same way, was not also Rahab the prostitute justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out another way? For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is," say it, "dead." Join with me as we pray. Lord God, I thank you for your word. I thank you, God, for what we've seen and heard and experienced already in this place tonight. And Father, I pray for those in this room who need to respond to your word with saving faith. Lord, I pray that you would take the blinders off of our eyes. I pray, God, that you would soften the hardness of our hearts. I pray, God, that you would break down the concrete barriers of our pride. And God, I pray that you would show us before you whether we have the kind of faith that your word says is saving faith. I pray, Lord, for those who in this place tonight need to get saved. Lord, show them how much they need you. I pray, God, for those who tonight who are saved, but they aren't living like they're saved. God, convict our hearts that we might live a changed life. I pray, God, for those who need to pray for and witness to family members who are unsaved. And Lord God, just use your word to burden us for them. I pray, God, for those who need to show that they're saved by following you in believer's baptism. And God, I pray that tonight you would convict them and that they would simply say yes to you. We'll give you glory and honor for all that you do, Lord. For we pray these things in Jesus' precious name. And church, if you agree with that prayer, will you say amen? Amen. You may be seated. Now, if the Bible only said it one time, if in just one place in Scripture, the Bible made the statement, faith without works is dead, that would be enough for all of eternity to establish that truth. But did you notice in this text, not just one time, but three times the Word of God says, faith without works is dead. Verse 17, faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. Dead. Again, deeper in the text, the Bible says that faith without works is useless. Verse 20. And again in verse 26, faith apart from works is dead. It's absolutely clear. Faith that is not accompanied by a changed life. And that's what the Bible is speaking of when it talks about works. Faith without a changed life. Faith without obedience, faith without surrender to Jesus Christ fully. Faith without works is dead. Three times this text declares that truth. And for that reason, this passage of Scripture is one of the most controversial passages in all of the New Testament. In fact, Martin Luther, the great reformer of the 16th century, believed that the book of James ought to be taken out of the New Testament altogether, because he found that this book, and especially this text, he thought it was in contradiction to the central truth that he proclaimed, which we were saved by grace alone through faith alone. And so he called the book of James an epistle of straw, and he just wanted to rip it out of the New Testament. I'll tell you something, Martin Luther was right about all kinds of things. He was wrong about that thing. But there are those who look at this passage of Scripture and they see what James says here in James chapter 2, and then they see what Paul says in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, very familiar verses of Scripture to us, where Paul writes, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast." And so the Word of God is really clear in the book of Ephesians that we're saved by God's grace through faith, and that our works do nothing to save us. And then James says that if we are saved and yet there's no change, or if we claim to have faith and yet there's no change in our lives, then that type of faith does not save us. And so some people have looked at those two passages of Scripture and imagined that James and Paul are like soldiers fighting hand to hand against one another. Friend, that is not true. James is God's truth. Ephesians and all of the New Testament is God's truth. And perfect truth can never contradict perfect truth. I'll say that one more time. Some of you want to say amen. Perfect truth can never contradict perfect truth. So it's not as though James and Paul are soldiers fighting hand to hand against one another. Instead, James and Paul are like soldiers fighting back to back against two different enemies. Paul was fighting against those who said, you know, if I'm good enough, if I'm moral enough, if I'm religious enough and ethical enough, then somehow my works can save me, and by my works I will be saved. And he says, nope, you are saved by God's grace through faith, and your works can never save you. He was fighting against that enemy. James was fighting against a different enemy. He was fighting against a different mindset. He was fighting against those who said, you know, I believe in God. I believe in Jesus. I've made a decision to call Jesus my Savior. I call myself a Christian. And so once I've done that, once I've been baptized, once I'm a church member, I can just turn around and live my life however I please and do what I want to and sin like I want to and live like I want to. And he says, absolutely not. Faith without works is dead. If you claim to have saving faith, but there's no change in your life, the Bible says that kind of faith will not save. And then after James says that, he gives us several different indications of what real saving faith looks like. That's what I want to talk to you about tonight. First of all, the Bible says saving faith is more than what you say. Saving faith is more than just a matter of what you say. Look again with me in the text in verse 14. And there James asked this question. What good is it, my brothers, if someone, what's the next word? Says. If someone says he has faith but does not have works. The word of God is very, very specific here. It says, what good does it do? What profit does it bring if someone says he has faith but does not have works, does not have a life of that's been changed, a life of obedience that comes from what he says he has. If he says he has faith but does not have works, here's the next question. Can that faith, can that kind of faith that he says he has, but a kind of faith that does not result in a changed life, can that kind of faith save him? And the implied answer is no, because saving faith is more than a matter of just what you say. Listen. Saying you're a Christian is not the same thing as being a Christian. And some of us have documentation even to say that we're a Christian. We got certificates, and we can say, here's when I got baptized, or we've got documentations. Hey, I'm on the church roll here. They've got me on the database, all those. And listen, all of those things are good and fine, but listen, just the word is not the same thing as being saved. Calling yourself a Christian, putting that label on yourself, saying that you're saved, is not the same thing as being saved. And James gives a very simple illustration of it. So he says, can that kind of faith, faith that somebody just says they have, but that's not accompanied by works, can that kind of faith save him? And here's the example he gives, the illustration. He says, if a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed and filled without giving them the things needed for the body. What good is that? I want you to imagine it's a cold, cold night. Maybe it's January, February. It's sleeting outside. The cold wind is blowing. You're inside your house. It's warm. You've just had a great meal to eat for dinner, and you're sitting there just sort of enjoying the night, letting that food settle in, just enjoying your warm house, and you can hear the sleet falling outside, and suddenly somebody knocks on your door, and you open the door, and there's a friend of yours. And for some reason, your friend, in the middle of this winter storm, is wearing shorts and just a T-shirt, and they're shivering there. And they said, listen, I've gotten stranded out on the road, and I'm really, really cold, and I haven't had anything to eat all day. Can you do something to help me? And you stand there at your door, and you say, friend, be warmed and well-fed, and then you slam the door on their face. What good have you done them? The answer is no good, because words cannot fill an empty stomach. And words cannot clothe a cold, shivering body. And the Bible says in the same way, just having the words, just saying you're a Christian, just saying that I'm a church member, just saying I'm saved is not the same thing as being saved. You know, there's something that we say in Baptist life. I'll say the first part of it. You say the second part of it. We say, once saved, what? Always saved. Here's the problem. I believe once saved, always. I believe once you're saved, you're always saved. Absolutely. That's what the Word of God teaches. But can I tell you something? We've got a lot of Baptist church members and other kinds of church members who were saying, always saved, and they never were once saved. They've never trusted Jesus as Savior. They say they're saved, Their name may be on a church membership roll somewhere. They call themselves a Christian, but the word is not the thing. When I was in college, I took a class called General Semantics. And one of the principles in general semantics is the word is not the thing. And so just to prove this, our professor, his name was Thomas Tedford. Dr. Tedford had us all take out a sheet of paper one day in class. He said, everybody take out a sheet of paper. Everybody took out a sheet of paper. And Dr. Tedford said, I want you to write at the top of your paper, hamburger. And everybody wrote hamburger at the top of the paper. And then he said, all right, what do you want on your hamburger? And we started calling things out. So I'll just let you guys do it right now. What do you want on your hamburger? Just call it out loud where I can hear you. Somebody said pickle. Somebody said mayonnaise. Did somebody say mustard? Somebody said ketchup. Somebody said cheese. I heard all those things at once when I just asked you to say something. And we just wrote down all these things, pickles and onions. And we wrote, he had us write down everything. He said, write down that whole thing, write everything. Write down the bun. Write down sesame seed bun. Write down special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onions. Write down all those things. He said, now I want you to take that list. He said, I want you to fold it up into a square. We fold it up into a square. He said, now I want you to take that and eat it. And then he said, the word is not the thing. Just putting a label on yourself and saying, I call myself a Christian, not the same thing as being saved. Just putting a label on yourself and saying, I'm a member of this church, not the same thing as being saved. Just putting a label on yourself and even saying, I'm saved, is not the same thing as being saved. Saving faith, according to the Word of God, is more than what you say. Secondly, the Bible shows us this. Saving faith is more than what you do. Saving faith is more than what you do. Now look in verse 18 of the text. And there James introduces someone who's sort of bringing up an argument. He says, but someone will say, you have faith and I have works. James says, show me your faith apart from your works and I will show you my faith by my works. And so he says, somebody will stand up in the church and say, listen, James, you have faith, but I have works. James, in other words, James, you're trusting in your faith in Jesus Christ to save you. You have faith, but James, I have works. I'm gonna be a good person. I'm gonna be a religious person. I'm gonna do good things. I'm gonna keep the Ten Commandments. I'm gonna obey the things that Jesus taught in the Sermon on the Mount. And if I do these things and keep the golden rule and everything else, if I do these things, James, you have faith, but I'm gonna work my way into heaven. You have faith, but I have works. Here's what James says, show me. He says, show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. Don't miss this. If we are truly saved, we will do the works. We will obey God. We'll keep his commands. We'll seek to please him with our lives, not in order to be saved, but because we have been saved. But please understand, you can do good things all your life. You can do religious things all your life. You can do moral things all your life. You can do Quail Springs Baptist Church things all your life without being saved. Because saving faith is more than just what you do. You can't do enough good things to make yourself right before God. In fact, the Bible says in the book of Isaiah that our works of righteousness are like filthy rags in God's sight. Think about that. It would be powerful enough and disturbing enough if the Bible says our sin is like filthy rags in God's sight. But that's not what the Bible says. God says our righteousness, our best days, the best things we ever do, are like filthy rags in God's sight. Saving faith is more than what you do. I brought something with me tonight. I just want you to see if you agree with me on these things. I brought something that I call the Ten Commandments of airplane travel. Everybody with me just for a few minutes? Ten Commandments. Some of these things are actual rules. Some of these things are just things you ought to do. But I'm going to give you 10 commandments for airplane travel. See if you agree with me on these. Number one, I will listen to the instructions of the flight attendants. Number two, I will buckle my seatbelt for takeoff and landing, and at any other time the fastened seatbelt light is on. Number three, I will put my cell phone into airplane mode. Number four, I will keep my seat in the upright position when I'm supposed to. Number five, I will keep my tray table locked when I'm supposed to. Number six, I will obey the armrest hierarchy. Here's the armrest hierarchy. If you're on the window seat, enjoy your view, one armrest for you. If you're on the aisle seat, enjoy your access to the restroom, one armrest for you. If you are in the middle seat, you get complete, unfettered access to both armrests. Everybody say amen. That's the armrest hierarchy. That's number six. Number seven, I will not take off my shoes and socks. Number eight, I will not smoke or subject my fellow passengers to any other noxious fumes or perfumes. Number nine, I will use headphones or earbuds at all times. Number 10, if my kids are traveling with me, I will not take a mild sedative and expect my fellow passengers to entertain my children while I sleep. Would everybody sort of agree with me to sign on to those 10 commandments? Now, I want you to imagine something. I want you to imagine that I come up to the gate to get on the airplane, and I get up and I say, hey, let me on this plane. I promise to buckle my safety belt. Will that get me on the plane? The answer is no. I promise to use earbuds. Will that get me on the plane? Nope. I promise not to smoke. I promise to keep my tray table in the locked position where I'm supposed to. I promise, I could promise to do all of those things. None of those things will get me on the plane. What gets me on the plane? A ticket. And God gives us all kinds of commands and principles He wants us to live by as His people. And they're intended for us once we've been saved, but none of those things save. Only faith in Jesus Christ saves. You have to come to Him and say, Jesus, I know there's nothing I can do to save myself. I know I'm a sinner, and even my righteousness is like filthy rags to You. But Jesus, I believe You died on the cross for my sin, and I believe You rose from the grave to give me eternal life. And so, Jesus, I ask for You to save me, and I trust in You to save me and to change my life. Saving faith is more than what you do. And be careful of this, because you can do all kinds of things and still be lost. A $20 bill began to circulate, and it went to all kinds of places. It did all kinds of good things. That $20 bill went to a little family and helped to pay for their electric bill one month. It went to the bank account of a widow woman. It helped buy her groceries one week. Somebody put that $20 bill in the offering plate, and it was used to buy or to take the gospel of Jesus Christ all over the world through missions. But then one day that $20 bill found its way into the hands of a banker, and he looked at that and said, that's not a real $20 bill. And he tore it up because he knew it was a counterfeit. Listen, a counterfeit Christian can do all kinds of good things. You can teach Sunday school classes. You can help people who are hurting. You can give to charity. You can go on mission trips. You can preach sermons. But one day, we're going to stand before the One who knows whether we're the genuine article or not. And when we stand before Jesus Christ, the Bible says that He is going to look at us with fiery eyes that burn through all of the pretense in our lives. I'm asking you the question,
will your faith, the kind of faith you have, save you? Saving faith is more than what you say. Saving faith is more than what you do. Number three, the Bible shows us saving faith is more than what you know. Saving faith is more than what you know. Now look in verse 19 of the text. The Bible says, you believe that God is one, you do well. Stop right there. The beginning place of faith is to believe in the one living God, the God who created heaven and earth, the living God of Abraham and Jacob and Isaac, the living God of Israel revealed in the Old Testament. So when James wrote this, he was writing primarily to Jewish believers. And he just started off by saying, you believe that God is one, you do well. He was pointing back to Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4. That's the great confession of faith in the Old Testament that simply says this, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one God. So you can't be saved without having that beginning point of believing that there is one God, the God revealed in the Bible. But notice what the Bible says. You believe that God is one, you do well. But you find yourself in interesting company because the Bible says, even the demons believe and shudder. The word believe can sometimes mean just to know and agree with something. And there are a lot of people who think that if they just know the facts about who God is and who Jesus is and what Jesus did on the cross and what it means to be saved, if they just know those facts, that knowing and agreeing with those facts is the same thing as saving faith. The Bible says it's not. Saving faith is more than just what you know. You believe that God is one. You do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. In my Bible, I've underlined that word shudder. It's a word that literally means to stand on end. It's the picture of a demon hearing the name of God or being in the presence of Jesus. This happened in the Gospels as demons were brought into the presence of Jesus and they trembled with fear so that the hair on the back of their neck stood up on end. Even the demons believe and shudder. Do you realize that the devil believes everything the Bible teaches us about everything? He believes everything the Bible teaches about Jesus. I just want you to imagine that one Sunday here at Quail Springs Baptist Church, as I'm giving the invitation, we're standing here at the front, and as I'm standing there giving the invitation, the devil steps out of a pew and walks down the aisle and says, Pastor, I'd like to present myself for membership at Quail Springs Baptist Church. Would you want me to ask the devil a few questions before we decided whether or not he could become a member? Well, I might ask him a few questions. I might say, well, devil, is this your first time here at our church? He'd say, no, I come every Sunday. Because he's here every Sunday. And I'd say, well, devil, listen, I know a lot of our members are already pretty familiar with you, but let me just ask some things just so we'll know since you won't become a member of the church. Devil, do you believe that Jesus is God's son? And the devil would say, oh, yes. Before I rebelled against God, I was a ministering spirit, a ministering angel in heaven. I saw him on his throne in heaven. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Well, now, devil, do you believe that Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary? The devil would say, oh, I know that's true. I did everything I could to snuff out his life in its infancy. But no, I believe that Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary. Well, now, devil, do you believe that Jesus lived a perfect and sinless life? And he would say, oh, I know that's true. I threw every temptation I had at him, and yet every time he overcame me and he defeated me. But yes, I know that Jesus lived a perfect and sinless life. Well, devil, this is a Baptist church. Now, do you believe in baptism by immersion? And he would say, well, that's how John the Baptist baptized Jesus in the River Jordan. I saw that right before I started tempting him. He was baptized. So yes, I believe in baptism by immersion. Well, now, devil, do you believe that Jesus died on the cross? And the devil would smile a wide smile, and he'd say, oh, yes, I believe that. That was the greatest day in all of my existence. I thought I had defeated him then. Well, devil, do you believe that Jesus rose from the grave on the third day? And he would hang his head and say, oh, yes, I believe that. That was the worst day of my existence. I knew he defeated me then. Well, devil, do you believe that Jesus is coming back one day? I know he is, and I know my time is short. I could go all the way through this Bible. The devil believes every part of it. The devil is completely orthodox in everything he believes. He could teach at one of our seminaries. He may have been my Old Testament professor, I'm not sure. But if I were to ask him, devil, you've been in rebellion against holy God. Have you turned from your rebellion and sin and turned to Jesus and asked him to forgive you and save you? Have you asked him to change you? Then he would begin to tremble, and the hair on the back of his neck would stand up on end as he shuddered, and he would say, no, 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 I hate Jesus, and I reject him completely. Now hear me, I love you with all my heart, but there are some people in this room who aren't that much different than the devil himself in this regard. You know and even accept all the right things about Jesus, but he's never changed you. Someone has said the distance between heaven and hell is 18 inches. It's the distance between your head and your heart. Friend, being saved is not just a matter of saying, uh-huh, to a list of facts about Jesus. Sometimes we make it that way. Uh-huh, I believe Jesus is God's son. Uh-huh, I believe he died on the cross. Uh-huh, I believe he rose from the grave. Uh-huh, I believe he saves everyone who calls on his name. Saying uh-huh and just knowing those things is not the same thing as being saved. Saving faith is more than what you know. Listen, there are people in hell who know John 3:16. There are people in hell who know the words of all kinds of gospel songs and hymns and contemporary Christian songs. There are people in hell who could explain the plan of salvation. There are people in hell who preached a message like I'm preaching to you tonight. Because listen, being saved is not just knowing stuff about Jesus. It's more than what you say. It's more than what you do. It's more than what you know, so you would ask the question, well, then what is saving faith? Look in your Bible in verse 20 again. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person? I don't like him calling us foolish people, but there he did it. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? And from there, James gives us two examples of what real saving faith looks like. I'll give you what the truth is, and then I'll show you that truth in this text. Here's what real saving faith is. Saving faith is trust in Jesus that changes your life. Does anybody want to say amen to that? Saving faith is trust in Jesus that changes your life. And then James gives us two examples of people who trusted the Lord and it changed their life. He starts off with Abraham, the great patriarch, verse 21. The Bible says, was not Abraham our father justified? That word justified means shown to be right with God. Was not Abraham our father shown to be right with God by works, by what he did when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? You go back in your Bible to Genesis chapter 22, and there you encounter the patriarch Abraham. God came to Abraham when Abraham and his family were worshiping idols. when he and his wife Sarah were very old and had had no children together. And God came to Abraham and said, Abraham, I'm going to take you to a land you've never seen before that you don't know about, and I'm going to turn you into a great nation, and I'm going to bless you, and through you, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. And I'm going to give you so many children. He said, Abraham, look up at the stars of the sky. He said, Abraham, can you count the stars in the sky? And Abraham said, no, Lord. He said, well, that's how many offspring you're going to have. It's going to be incredible. I'm going to make you a great nation. And Abraham believed. He believed God. God came and told Abraham and Sarah when he was 99 years old and she was 89 years old that in 1 year she would give birth to her firstborn son. She's 89, he's 99. They laughed when God told them that. And a year later, she gave birth to her firstborn son. They named him after laughter. His name means laughter. His name is Isaac. Can you imagine a 90-year-old woman and a 100-year-old man enrolling in the new parent Sunday school class at the church? But Abraham and Sarah, in their old age, received that promise from God. And he loved that boy, Isaac. He watched him grow. All of his hopes and dreams were in that boy. And then one day, God came to Abraham and called him to do something unthinkable, even unspeakable. He said, Abraham, I want you to take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and I want you to take him to the top of that mountain over there, and I want you to sacrifice him to me. And Abraham said, yes, Lord. They got up in the morning, began to make their way to the top of that mountain. By this time, Isaac was old enough to understand sort of what was happening. He said, Dad, I see that you've got the wood for the altar. I see you've got the torch with the flame. And he said, but Dad, where's the lamb for the sacrifice? Abraham said, God himself will provide a lamb. Abraham went to the top of Mount Horeb. He built that altar there. He bound up his son. He laid out his son, his only son, whom he loved, Isaac, across that altar. He reached into his belt, pulled out a shiny, sharp flint knife, and as he held it over the quivering chest of his son, his only son, Isaac, whom he loved, at that moment, Abraham showed he had believed years before. It was at the point of obedience, a changed life, that Abraham showed he had faith. And you know the story. There in the thicket was caught a ram. God himself had provided a lamb for the sacrifice, and he sacrificed that ram in the place of his son. But the day came when God did not spare his own son, but he took him up to the top of the mountain called Calvary, and there he allowed him to be crucified and to die in your place for your sin, because he loves you so much and he wants to save you. Abraham showed that he was right with God and that he had saving faith through a changed life. James gives the example of Abraham, but some of them may have heard that and thought, well, that's Abraham. My goodness, he's the father of the nation. He's the father of faith. He's the friend of God. Surely God wouldn't expect me to have the same kind of faith as Abraham the patriarch. And so James gives another example. He gives the example of Rahab the prostitute. Look in verse 25. And in the same way, was not also Rahab the prostitute justified, shown to be right with God, by works, by obedience, by a changed life, when she received the messengers and sent them out another way? Rahab. I've known girls named Elizabeth. That's a biblical name. I've known girls named Mary and Martha and Elizabeth and Miriam and Rebecca and all those biblical. I've never known a girl named Rahab. Have you? I guess it's because of that word that always goes with her name, Rahab the what? Rahab the prostitute. That's what she was. Do you notice I use the past tense? That's what she was. That's what she had been. But the Bible tells us that Rahab, a sinful woman, living a sinful life in the sinful city of Jericho, she began to hear about the armies of Israel that were fast approaching her city of Jericho as they marched across the desert. And she heard about the living God of Israel who was giving them victory over enemy after enemy after enemy. And she heard about the living God and she believed. She had faith. But she showed she had faith at the point of obedience, a changed life, when spies from Israel came into her place and she hid them and sent them out another way so that they would not be taken captive by the people of Jericho. And as a result, she and her family were spared when the city of Jericho fell down, when the walls fell down and the city was defeated. The Bible says she was shown to be just through her works. She showed that she had a right relationship with God through a changed life. And that truth is still true today. Saving faith is trust in Jesus that changes your life. I'm not asking you if you're on a church roll. I'm not asking you if you've been baptized. I'm not asking you if you're a good person. I'm not asking you if you call yourself a Christian. I'm asking you, have you trusted in Jesus Christ and has he changed your life? Because if he hasn't changed your life, then the Bible says where there's no change, there's no Jesus. Where there's no change, there's no saving faith. Look in verse 26. For as the body apart from the spirit, that means breath, a body without breath is dead. You don't have to be a medical doctor to understand that. A body that cannot breathe is dead. And the Bible says in the same way, faith that is not accompanied by a changed life, faith apart from works, is dead. Dan and Martha loved one another. He wanted her to marry him. He couldn't afford a real engagement ring, and so he went to some little shop, bought an artificial gold band with some type of glass stone that sort of looked like a diamond. It didn't really. But he got it and brought it to her house, got down on one knee and said, Martha, this ring is not real, but my love for you is real. I want you to marry me. And she said, oh, Dan, I'd love to marry you. And she put that artificial gold, fake diamond ring on her finger. And they were married 20 years. They started raising a family together. Along the way, Dan got some promotions at work. He started doing better. And for their 20th anniversary, he wanted to get something to just show Martha how special she was to him. And so he went out and he bought the prettiest gold band he could find and the biggest diamond that he could afford. And he had it put in a little black velvet box and brought it home from work that day. Martha was at the kitchen sink. She was washing some dishes, looking out the window, and sun was shining in, and Dan got right down behind her on one knee, and she turned around, and he opened up that box, and there was that diamond ring sparkling in the sunlight that came into that window, and he said, Martha, 20 years ago, I couldn't afford to get you a real diamond or a real gold band, but now I've got a ring for you that's just as real as my love for you is. Happy 20th anniversary. She took that box and she held it up. She looked at that diamond sparkling in the sunlight. And then she closed it and gave it back to Dan and said, Dan, I don't want it. She said, I've been wearing this for 20 years. I've gotten used to it. I'm comfortable with this. And in fact, if I put on that other ring, then everybody will know that all these 20 years I've been wearing something fake. And I just don't want to do that. So Dan, I'll just keep this and you take that back. And you say, why would anybody keep a cheap imitation when someone who loves them so much is offering them the real thing? May I ask you, why would anybody hold on to an artificial salvation, a fake faith, a faith that will not save you, that will not take you to heaven, that will take you to hell? Why would you hold on to that when someone who loves you with all of his heart went to the cross of Calvary and died for your sins, rose from the grave on the third day so that your life can be changed? Why would you let embarrassment keep you from receiving the real thing? Why would you let the fact that maybe you've been a member of this church or some other church for a long, long time, why would you say, well, I can't do that? Why would you hold on to something that will not save when God is offering you the real thing? Some of you are here tonight, and more than anything else, God wants you to let go of that fake faith that won't save you and grab hold of Jesus Christ by faith, who will save you and who will change your life forever. Saving faith is trust in Jesus that changes your life. I brought another Bible with me tonight. It's a Bible that I had when I was a teenager, and I'm looking at it and assuming that when I was a teenager I could read this print in this Bible. But I didn't bring it to you to read to you from it. I want to tell you about something that happened when I was 18 years old. I got saved when I was a little boy, 6 years old, between my kindergarten and first grade year. I trusted Jesus as my Savior. I asked Him to come into my heart and give me His gift of eternal life. And then as I got older, and especially as I moved into my teenage years, I began to live less and less and less for Jesus. You couldn't tell on the outside. Nobody could tell. I was in church every time the doors were open. But I knew, and God knew, that the life I was living didn't look like a saved person's life. One Sunday afternoon, I'd been to church that morning. That afternoon, I went to my dad's barber shop. My job on the weekends was to clean up his shop. And I'd sweep up all the hair and wash the floors. And I just want to tell you right now, you have no idea how much hair there is on the floor in a barber shop. And you don't want to know. Don't look behind anything in your barber shop, because there's hair everywhere. But I was cleaning up that shop. I don't know what the preacher had said that morning. I really don't know. I just know God began to work in my heart. I looked at my life. There didn't seem to be a lot of evidence. Stephen, are you saved? And I decided that afternoon that when I finished cleaning that shop, I was going to drive across town to my pastor's house. I'd never been to his house. I'd barely ever had a conversation with him other than just to say hello on Sunday morning. But I was going to drive to his house and make sure I was saved, get him to talk to me and make sure I was saved. I remember driving across town, and I was thinking, please, Lord, don't let me be in an accident on the way to the pastor's house. I don't want to get killed. I'm not sure if I'm saved. And then I thought the rapture could come. Lord, please don't let the rapture come before I get to my pastor's house. I'll make sure I'm saved. I prayed that all. I'm serious. Prayed it all the way there. I got to his house, knocked on the door. He was so kind. He came out unannounced. I showed up. He came out. He sat down with me in his living room. And I just told him what I was feeling and experiencing. And he said, Stephen, you know what? I think you need to pray a prayer of assurance. And just to pray and say, Jesus, help me to know that I'm saved. And help me to live like I'm saved. And that day in his house, I prayed that prayer. And then I came home to my house and I did something that he asked me to do. I took this little Bible, and there in the front of this Bible, in red pen, an 18-year-old boy wrote, "Date of assurance, March 1st, 1987, praise the Lord." You say, "Stephen, do you think you were saved that day?" No, I know I was saved when I was 6 years old, but I'll tell you something. That day changed my life because I began to nail it down and to live for Jesus in changed life as I gave myself to him. Some of you are here tonight and you're not saved and you need to get saved. In just a moment, I'm going to pray a simple prayer and invite you to pray with me to ask Jesus to save you. Some of you are here tonight and you may need to do what I did, just pray a prayer of assurance and say, "Jesus, I've got some real questions about whether I'm saved because I know I'm not living like I'm saved." And tonight, you want to pray and say, "Jesus, change my life. Help me to live for you." Some of you are here tonight, and there are people in your family or friends, and tonight, God is showing you something. God is showing you that you've been praying the wrong way for your friend or family member. Because maybe you've got a friend, or maybe you've got a child or a grandchild, and what you've been thinking is, they're saved and away from God. And what God's showing you tonight is they've never been saved. And you need to pray for that person to be saved and look for opportunities to talk to that person about being saved. Some of you are here tonight and you need to come to show that you're saved by being baptized. Being baptized doesn't save you, but being baptized shows that there's been a change in your life. And this Sunday, we're going to have a time of baptism. Some of you need to get your baptism on the right side of your salvation. Some of you need to get your baptism just in order and do that and say, "Lord, I'm going to follow you and get my baptism right to show that I'm saved." So I want you to bow your heads and close your eyes all across this room. I'm asking this question tonight. Will your faith save you? Heavenly Father, we thank you that you sent your Son Jesus that we might be saved, that our lives would be changed, and that we might know that we're saved. Your word says, "These things are written that you may know that you have eternal life." So, Father, I pray for those in this room tonight who tonight, maybe they've said they were Christians. Maybe they've gone through the motions. Maybe they've done some good things and some religious things. Maybe they know the right answers to the questions. But, Lord, tonight, they look at their life and they realize there's been no change. And tonight they want to make sure they're saved. In this quiet moment with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, I ask you, if you're unsaved or unsure, I want to invite you to pray a simple prayer with me, asking Jesus to save you and to change you. Here's the good news. He promises he will. He saves everyone who calls on him, and he changes everyone he saves. And right now, you can pray and call on Jesus. He promises he'll save you. You can pray a prayer like this. You pray it in your heart, or you can pray it and just whisper it with your lips as I pray it out loud. Pray this way. Dear Jesus, just right now pray, "Dear Jesus, I believe you are God's Son. I believe you died on the cross to pay for my sins. And Jesus, right now, I trust in you to save me. Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Lord, I'm sorry for those things I've done that do not please you. Lord, I'm sorry for going through the motions and playing religious games. Lord, I ask you to save me and change me. And Lord, by your grace, help me to live my life for you. That the works of my life, that the actions of my life would show that I'm saved. Save me now. And Jesus, help me to walk with you. For I pray this, Jesus, in your name. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, if you prayed that prayer with me, in just a moment when we stand to sing a final song, I'll be here at the front. Others will be here as well. And I'm inviting you to step out of your seat and walk down one of these aisles and just take one of us by the hand. And all you need to say is, I prayed that prayer. That's all you need to say. We want to help you take your next steps with Jesus. We want to give you a Bible. We want to help you begin to grow in your faith. We want to help you get baptized. All of those things that come with following Jesus. And so if you meant business with the Lord, the first step to show that he's changed your life will be your step to come down here at the front and say, I prayed that prayer. Some of you need to come. Some of you are longtime church members here or somewhere else, but you know that tonight you prayed that prayer and really meant it. And tonight you need to come. And then there are others here tonight. And you would say, Pastor, I know I'm saved. But I haven't been living a changed life. And tonight I want to come and just get before God at this altar and pray and ask for God to change my life. And in the things I do and the things I say, I want people to see Jesus in me. And friend, I'll tell you something. When you come and meet God at an altar, you know, the altar is like God's office. It's always open. You come and kneel before the Lord and just bring something to him, and it changes you. It's a step of obedience. Some of you tonight need to come and just say, I'm going to kneel at this altar just for a moment and say, Jesus, help me to live a changed life. Others of you are here and you want to come and pray for somebody in your life who needs to be saved. Others here need to come to say, yes, Jesus, I'll follow you by being baptized. Lord, we give this time of invitation to you. We pray, God, that you would use it in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Let's stand to our feet as we stand and as we sing. You come.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I but now am found, was blind, but now I see. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. The Lord has promised good. word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. Jesus,
standing next to someone that you know, maybe someone that you don't know that well, but I want you to do something. I want you to turn to one another and just ask this question: do you know that you're saved? Will you just do that? Turn to somebody close to you. Ask them, do you know that you're saved? And just answer. If the answer is yes, praise the Lord. If the answer is no, we want to pray for it. If the answer is I'm not sure, we want to help you be sure. How many of you are glad you're saved in this place tonight? Amen. Amen. Our God is so good to us. Listen, if somebody asked you that question and you didn't really know how to answer, or if the answer was no, this invitation is still open. You need to come. Don't leave this place unsaved or unsure. Don't leave this place without Jesus. We're going to bow our heads. We're going to close our eyes. The music is going to continue to play. Ministers are here at the front. Maybe you're standing next to somebody who you just need that to ask them to come down to the front with you, to encourage you, because you need to come and get things right with the Lord tonight. We're just extending this opportunity. If you need to come, you come. You come. Father in heaven, we love you, we praise you, we thank you for a wonderful night in your house. Thank you, God, for working and speaking to our hearts. Thank you, Lord, for people who made decisions tonight. Lord, thank you for those who are praying for their friends who need to be saved. Thank you, Lord, for those who are praying for their family members. And Lord, I pray that you would open our lips and give us obedient hearts and wisdom to share and to talk to people who we care about, people you placed in our lives. Talk to them about where they're going to spend eternity. Thank you, God, for those who have been saved tonight. Thank you, Lord, for those who have asked for you to change their lives and change the way they live day by day as believers. Now, Lord God, as we go out from this place, we pray that we would go out in your joy, in your peace. We thank you, God, for the power of your gospel. Bring us back again tomorrow night. Lord, give us opportunities to invite people to come, burden our hearts to pray for them, and Lord, do a work. For we pray these things in Jesus' precious name. And church, if you agree, will you say amen? Amen and amen. Has it been a good night in the Lord's house? Let's give God glory and praise for his presence in this place. I'm thankful to God for the Bolerjacks. I want to remind you they have a product table out in the archways. I hope you'll stop by and see them and talk to them tonight. Thank them for the wonderful music. I also want to remind you, if you need to make a decision for Jesus, we'll be in the archways area there at the welcome desk. There are people there to encourage you. If you prayed to receive Christ and have not come forward, just tell someone at the back desk that you prayed to receive Christ. We've got a Bible we want to give you, and we want to help you take your first steps with the Lord. And then also, if you're our guest, stop by. We've got a gift that we love to give you, a book that I wrote called Moving Forward Day by Day. It's a daily devotional that I believe will be a blessing to you. You can stop by and pick that up on your way out. God bless you. Thanks for being here. Have a great night.